Hi, I'm Nate, and you're watching Photolearningism. Wanted to reach back to a topic that we touched on way, way back. DigiKam, a really fantastic open source tool for managing your photos, and it does way more than just it sounds. What if you find yourself in a situation where you use the default database to collect up all the metadata, the thumbnails, and all that, and it started getting really slow? Then what? Well, let's take a look at it, and let's just see what happens. So once again, I'm Nate. This is Photolearningism. Thank you so much for joining in. If this is your first time, I do a whole lot of work on this channel to service the cheap or free art technologies so that you can know about them and make good use of them. Thank you for being here. So DigiKam, gosh, it's been a long time. I wanted to dig back into this because they've made some strides, they've made some advancements, and I haven't talked about it in a while. There's been just so much going on in the open source community. So reaching back to this, I started to realize that as I was using it and as it tried to keep pace with itself, I took a lot of pictures over the last few years, and the default database that it uses, which is the one that you typically would use because it's very easy, it's just a couple of clicks and it's good to go without some, you know, that much configuration. It's called SQLite, and it actually has a very limited threshold of what you can do with it. That's this one here. Now, if you're looking to scale up, I believe the guide is if you're going to have under 1,000 pictures and that's just where you're going to stay, then SQLite will most likely be a reasonable fit. It doesn't require any special configuration, and it's more or less good to go. One click, you're done. However, if you're going to find yourself in a situation where you move beyond that 1,000 picture threshold, just kind of on and on, storage and sky's the limit, well, it starts to get really slow because it can't keep pace with that limited technology and the amount of images and the amount of data associated with those images, and especially when you're looking at search indexes and things that DigiKam is trying to offer you to expedite how you find things and organize things, it starts to choke itself a little bit. So moving off of SQLite, there's a few steps and I wanted to walk you through them. What I will say is that as we go into MySQL internal, this was kind of helpful in that it points you to where you can get the installers, and that may be the only purpose of it, honestly, because I could not find a version of MySQL that's called MySQL internal, at least for what I was able to trace out. So I think this is just kind of a guide to help you get your hands on these files. And what I noticed when I started stepping into that was this does not actually point you to MySQL proper, which confused me at first because I've used MySQL in the past. It's open source. Why wouldn't it do that? Instead, it points you to this MariaDB project, and I made sure that I didn't get kind of sidetracked or redirected along the way. I got a little worried, and I started reading into this a little bit. And as you start to pull this apart, you realize, okay, well, this is actually a project from the original MySQL developers who really wanted to create a technology that stayed not just open source, but free. Because that's the big difference here. If you go look up on MySQL, they now work purely on customer-based solutions. It's still considered open source. I guess that's where the technology stems from, but you got to pay for it now. So you still get kind of core MySQL. In fact, some of the files coming with MariaDB are still called MySQL, but you've got to download it from here, and it sends you straight there. So as long as you use those download links, actually really only one of them really, because you get both of them by doing it, that's very, very easy just using this MySQL internal. So that's where you begin with that. The next thing you have to do once you have those files is you actually have to start setting up the database. You have to install the service, you have to spin it up, you have to create a database, and you have to do some of the steps. So I'm going to walk you through what that looks like, all right, particular to the MariaDB, all right? So specific to MariaDB, once you've downloaded those files using the link provided from DigiKam, you will have to walk through the installation, and I did take some screenshots here to kind of help what I discovered through this to see if it might help you. I kept the default options as they were up front. Next screen, this is where you got to enter in your root account. You put in the root, you put in the password, and don't lose it, and everything else kept the same. You can kind of play with these other options. I'm working purely on a remote, purely on a local sense, not remote. So I didn't check that off. If you might consider scaling up to sharing over a network or sharing with multiple people on a server, that might be something that you might want to check on, but I didn't have that situation, so I didn't use it. All right, now this is interesting. I tried using a different name other than the service name that they populate, which is just MariaDB. Don't change that, by the way. There's a field there, you can, it fails every time I tried it. That was problem number one. Problem number two is with the networking piece of this, which you do have to have on, by the way, because even in a local sense, you're using the loopback adapter and it's networking locally within itself, which I know sounds confusing, but you have to have it on. That's the pipeline that it uses to talk. I tried upping the page size as well, because if you look into the specifics on the site, it talks about how you can scale up to different sizes of tables based on the page size. And I wanted to see, can I make this bigger? And oddly enough, if I tweaked it above 16, that also caused a problem. So that might be a thing where they're kind of working out some of the kinks there, or it could just be my computer's ability to support that. I don't really know. But again, that was my experience, so you may have to keep that on 16, which is still a lot of space. And yeah, these are the different pieces that I just mentioned here. The 64 KB as a page size is up to 256 terabytes. That's actually higher than I thought. After that point, I just followed the rest of the wizard and it finished up, and then I was able to plug it into DigiKam, which is what we'll do next. I had to fire up something that comes alongside with these downloadable things called Heidi SQL. And you have to make a new session to start. All right, you go down here to this new button, create session in root folder. There's a couple of quick questions that have to happen. I just kept the host as 127.0.0.1. For the uninitiated, that's just your local IP. It's the loopback adapter. It only lives on your computer. There's nowhere else that could possibly go unless you've gone into your host file and redirected it. But otherwise, there's nowhere else that could possibly go. All right. Everything else I kept as default and connected to it, okay? And I'm sorry, actually, yeah, I have to specify a password as well. That's important too. So whatever password makes sense, something that you're going to remember, because if you lose that, that's pretty much dead. You need to have your root password. That is the super user account in this case. Then do that and create your session. Now, once you're in a session, I'm gonna work off that here. Connect to this one, then you have the ability to work with databases within. Now it comes pre-baked with some databases here already. There's one called MySQL, which if you try to use that one, by the way, it'll fail if you try to transition to that because it's already got an established schema built within it of databases and tables, and it can't overwrite that. So it kind of comes built in. When you start using it, you have to make a brand new database, and that's actually pretty straightforward. When you do that, if you were to right click on your session, just create new database, you give it a name. I kept it with the default collation and it was spun up. It was blank, but it was spun up, which is what you want. You want a blank database where you can have DigiKam populate in the tables and things that it needs. Now, the other step that I had to do was go into the users. That's this kind of people looking button. And I had to add in this DigiKam user. And give it full rights, because that's what DigiKam is going to use when it, again, does all this work on your behalf. It has to know how to interact with this database. So I did that, and then I flip back over here into DigiKam. In settings, we actually had to do a database migration, and in here, started by selecting SQL Server, because again, internal doesn't show you anything except the download file, so you got to flip over to MySQL Server. Put in that root user and password that you set up. This can remain blank. I didn't have to do anything there. The host name you have to fill out. Again, that's the loopback adapter in this case. Checking the connection, it should, assuming the service is running, be good to go. And keep the default name as DigiKam. Again, we went and created that database. You do have to do that. So just keep the name the same and load that as all these variables and then start your process. All right. So it will populate into that database you made all the tables and things that you need. It'll move over all the data that you've already collected, which is really useful. It will take a while. If you've accumulated a lot of pictures, this took probably about 2 to 3 hours to ratchet through. Now, arguably, that could be my computer. This is not turn of the century technology I'm using, but it was quite a substantial amount of time to move, to create, and to push all that from the SQLite technology into the MySQL one, or MariaDB, really. So that finished up, and even when that finished, the process was not done, because what we had to do next was we then had to go back into the settings here, and we had to configure DigiKam, and finally, we had to flip this, because this will still be SQLite, we had to flip that over to MySQL Server, again, put in our specifics here. You can again check your connection, make sure that it's at least seeing the database, and then click OK. And that, again, took a little bit more time to catch up, re-import the stuff that you have on file in that database, and just make sure that it's detecting new stuff from there. I will say, though, once that painful process is done of making the transition, the scalability was there, and I could feel the difference. I could see the difference as I was using this tool. When I go to look at things like people classification and things, so much faster. The indexing process was way faster because the capabilities of that database technology is just more robust. It is more fine-tuned towards large-scale data. So I would highly suggest this if right out of the get-go, actually, if you're considering a photo management solution and you're looking for something that has a lot of inventory, over 1,000 pictures, definitely go this way right from the start, because it saves you some pain up front of doing the migration and having to move over all that stuff. You can just dip right into the MySQL database and leverage that benefit as you go. So the reason the database aspect is so important, and really the strength of DigiKam, is its ability to capture metadata. This is one of my favorite aspects, is that you can start tagging and classifying faces, and it will somewhat intelligently begin detecting those things. You have modes that do that for you, which is really cool, and you can help start sorting your images and categorizing them that way. There's of course the traditional other tag mechanisms, which is another thing that we can do. It is work to do, but the smarter you make the system, the more it works for you, and that's again a strength of this photo management tool, in that you can really extend out how well and how intelligently you classify, which empowers the tool to index and to give you more powerful results. As you start to do things like searching, you can actually find more closely matched results to those things, and it's a teachable system, which is really cool. So that's really the high level gist of this thing. I've talked about DigiKam in the past and about some of its features. I'll put a card over to the link so you can watch that and get a good sense of what else it can do. I really wanted to focus on the database aspect, though, because that kind of, I hit a point where it was just so slow trying to keep up with itself, and this helped so much, and I thought that might be helpful for you too if you're thinking of working in the scale that I've found myself in. So that's that. Once again, I'm Nate. This is Photolearningism. I hope this was useful information for you. If it was, consider giving me a thumbs up and subscribe if you haven't done that already. And also leave a comment. Join the conversation of the community of learners that we've worked hard to build, to cultivate a group of like-minded folks so we can share our experiences and make each other stronger as we go and navigate these tools. Thanks for being here, and thanks for spending your time with me. I'll see you at the next video.